And that was a big situation. There were 160,000 Allied soldiers that landed that day, and he was part of the first wave that landed at H-hour plus 60 minutes. This is the entry that he did for a letter that he sent to my mom. This is an edited version here. This is D-Day. H-hour is 6:30 a.m. I am fine and well and safe. Didn't even get a scratch. I don't imagine it is necessary for me to tell you that I am in France. I wonder if you would mind too much if I told you how close I came to making you a widow. Jerry didn't seem too pleased with the prospect of us coming ashore, and he had quite a few underwater obstacles on the beach. As our landing craft came in, we hit a mine, which stopped the ship and set it on fire. We were then an easy target for his artillery, but his marksmanship was poor, and he only got one direct hit. That one hit did a lot of damage, though, and 10 more feet and I wouldn't be here to tell you about it. I got all my men off the ship, though, and I was the last soldier off the craft. We had to swim for shore, but we all made it. Our ship, like a horrible monster, is still lying there to remind us of that terrible experience. We came ashore without any equipment, and therefore were unable to get started with our mission for some time. My father was a executive officer of the 293rd JASCO, which laid telephone wires out there, and that was important for communications. They were abandoned on our landing craft. The water was at high tide when we landed. Not more than 20 feet of dry ground remained between the water and the only cover to shield us from the enemy. The front was only 100 yards away, and the enemy was so well concealed in a network of trenches and pillboxes that we could not see anything at which to fire. Our secret weapon proved to be a hindrance. They were dual-drive tanks, which were buoyed up by large tubes around their middle. The obstacles proved too much for them, and many of them blew up as they hit the mines. Others were unable to get over the steep embankment of shingles, which is above the beach. They proved an easy target for the German artillery fire. The beach was cluttered with our crowded and wounded men. And those of us who had never before been in battle were unable to escape the horror of the hundreds of torn and mangled bodies of dying and dead men lying thickly on the beaches. We were unable to go to our designated location and install our communications. I assembled my platoon and awaited further instructions from the battalion commander. It was then that I learned that 31 men had died in the landing craft which had brought us ashore. They were in the hold next to mine, and only a miracle saved us from the same fate. In the evening, we were to traverse the beach, so I set out to look for Lieutenant Fournier and the detachment he had brought ashore. I found them about a mile from their designated spot. This position had been secured, and the engineers elected to operate here for the time being. We decided to set across the top of the hill to select a route for the line, and we were under the impression that the hill had been cleared of the enemy, and we were making our way rather carelessly, stopping occasionally to observe the smashed rocket positions which lined the top of the hill and the entire length of the beach. As we neared our objective, a shot rang out and a bullet whistled over our heads. We were under the impression it had come from our own troops and might have thought that we were the enemy. Let's see. Moving on. Here it is. This time we hit the ground but decided to investigate. Vin remained where he was, and I jumped over the enemy trench and crawled to the edge of the hill. I was startled by a voice to my rear saying, "Sieg, Kamrad!" I turned to see a figure in German uniform waving a white flag. As I pointed the gun at him, he said, "Sieg, Kamrad!" and five others followed him out of their underground emplacement. We searched the prisoners, returned them to the beach, and turned them over to the custody of the military police. By this time, it was too late to lay the line which we had started, so I left Fournier and returned to where we had installed our command post. And that is pretty much an edited version of my father's D-Day experience, landing on the beach in a landing craft that got hit with a mine, losing 31 crew members, and then going on and capturing six German soldiers. You're listening to the Sons of the American Legion radio report here on WVOX 1460 AM and heard worldwide at WVOX.com. I'm John Charan along with Ken Kratzer, Jack McGurk. We'll be back after a brief Fox News break with a special guest talking about current military events, so stay tuned.